I could have advised the president or Donald Trump Jr., I would have said, go to Don McGahn. Don McGahn is a very, very competent lawyer who is the White House legal counsel and was the general counsel to the campaign. He would have said, you want to talk to an ex-KGB GRU agent and a Russian person represented as a Russian government lawyer, even though we now know she wasn't, about research on Hillary? Tell the FBI, don't bring those guys in here.
So had he taken it to a lawyer, that lawyer would have said no. Why? If it's not a crime, like Jay Sekulow is saying.
It is a crime to receive something of value when you are a campaign official from a foreign person or a foreign government. That may not be the best statute in the world, because you also have the freedom of speech to gather information from wherever you want. But when the Congress wrote the laws governing presidential campaigns, they said presidential campaigns cannot accept anything of value from a foreign person or a foreign government.
So hold on, rewind, because I know you were gone last week, so it's good to get your take on this, Judge. So you're saying, had he, because Don Jr. walked away from this saying she didn't have any information, there was no information exchange, they moved on to another topic, had he actually received information, you're saying that would have been...
That would have been a felony. That would have been the completion of a crime. So when like John Sununu, Bill just did a great interview with former Governor Sununu, who kept saying, just as Jay Sekulow, who we all know, yesterday, where's the crime, where's the statute
Correct.
That they violated? Often, these nonviolent criminal events don't happen all at once. They happen in stages. So the question is this enough to commence a criminal investigation? Answer, yes, because it is suspicious that they met with these people, that they didn't consult a lawyer, and that one of these people is a former KGB GRU, that's the Russian intelligence arm, Russian military intelligence arm, and didn't tell anybody about it. Why didn't Jared Kushner tell the FBI about
it?
So what
about that?
He filled out his FBI national security application, unless he was trying to hide something. And if he was trying to hide something, was it that this was a bumbling, foolish thing to do, or that this was the beginning of some steps in furtherance of acquiring this information?
And it is important.
Let's turn to Andrew Napolitano, Judge Andrew Napolitano, a senior judicial analyst. Mike Flynn appears to be right there about the crux of things.
A couple of months ago, President's lawyers and General Flynn's lawyers entered into an agreement that they would share evidence with each other. They would share...
There's a term for that.
It's called a joint defense agreement.
Mm-hmm.
They would share all communications that each side received from the special prosecutor, and they wouldn't point fingers at each other. On Thanksgiving Eve, after President Trump had left the White House from Mar-a-Lago, a letter arrived like a thunderbolt, and it was from General Flynn's lawyers to Don McGahn, the chief White House lawyer. We're out of the joint defense agreement. On Monday...
We were cooperating. We're not cooperating anymore.
Correct.
We're on different sides now.
Correct. On Monday, General Flynn's lawyers met with Bob Mueller's team. That means that they realize the gravity of the charges, potential charges, he hasn't been charged with anything as far as we know, against the general. They realize the incredible length of prison time that the general is facing if everything he's charged with, he's convicted on or pleads guilty to, and it's time to negotiate. So the tantalizing question is, what are they negotiating over? What does General Flynn have or know that would be of interest to Special Counsel Mueller?
Well, we know he has a story to tell because his lawyer told us that quite some time ago. He has a story to tell, he just needs to be able to tell it.
He would need to be able to tell a story that would involve President Trump and some...
Why?
Well, because Bob Mueller is interested in what the president knew and when he knew it about contacts with the Russians. There were 30 contacts between campaign people and the Russians.
And by the way, those were previously undisclosed.
Correct.
Asked and answered, no, we didn't do it. Now we know of 30.
So what did General Flynn know? When did he know it? What did the president know? When did he know it? What did Attorney General Sessions know and when did he know it? General Sessions is a problematic issue for the administration because he testified under oath several times he didn't know about these things.
And then we learned that he did.
Well, then we learned that he was in a room where they were discussed, but he said he didn't remember it. Hard to believe that he didn't know about it. So General Flynn probably is the linchpin here. Now, why is Jared Kushner being asked about General Flynn? Because one way to assure General Flynn's cooperation is to indict him anyway, to sort of keep his feet to the fire. And I think the special counsel believes that Jared Kushner is aware of the who, what, when, where of General Flynn's communications with his father-in-law, the president.
For the president, Has the seriousness of the matter changed since Thanksgiving?
Radically. If I could modify your question slightly to since Thanksgiving Eve. This letter arrived Wednesday night. Radically. Because the according to Jim Comey, the former FBI director, the president's primary focus was on not the government not prosecuting Mike Flynn. Now Mike Flynn's lawyers want him to become a witness for the government. Welcome to my chambers. Earlier this week, the government announced an indictment of two former colleagues of President Trump, one of whom was the campaign manager of his campaign during the summer of his triumph at the Republican National Convention in Cleveland, and the other a business partner. The allegations against these two, Paul Manafort and Rick Gates, are that they were actually agents of a foreign government and they failed to register with the American government, that they engaged in tax fraud, in money laundering, and in obstruction of justice. Does any of this have anything to do with Donald Trump? Well, generally, no. It has nothing to do with the investigation of whether somebody in Trump's campaign helped somebody in the Russian government hack emails of Hillary Clinton. That is being investigated by the Justice Department in the person of the independent counsel, Bob Mueller. So why would Mueller indict two of President Trump's former closest colleagues if they had nothing to do with the purpose of his investigation? Because the method of operating for federal prosecutors is to find somebody that knows the target. The target is Donald Trump, the President of the United States, and squeeze those people, not literally squeeze them, but threaten them with jail time, charge them with anything you can find against them in the hopes that they will give you information against the person you really want, the president. But lurking between the lines here was the guilty plea of one of the president's former colleagues. And after that person, George Papadopoulos, pleaded guilty in secret, something almost unheard of in the American system for a judge to lock the courtroom door, he probably wore a wire, and he probably went back to his former colleagues in the Trump campaign and probably tried to get them to incriminate themselves on the wire. When the prosecutor and defense counsel ask a judge to take a guilty plea in secret, that's about the only reason they can do so. If they persuade the judge that the public awareness of the guilty plea will interfere with a law enforcement procedure, in this case, trying to get somebody in the Trump White House to incriminate the president. Is this any way to run a prosecution? Secret wires, indicting people for crimes that have nothing to do with the president, and then squeezing these people to see if they'll cough up information? When you threaten somebody with 20 years in jail, they may say anything to you to reduce that exposure. Sadly, that is everyday life for federal prosecutors today. And it is a dangerous prosecutorial tool in a dangerous time for the president. Welcome to my chambers. Fight the good fight.
For freedom!
Welcome to my chambers. Last week, former FBI Director James Comey gave long-awaited testimony to the Senate Intelligence Committee and a national television office about his rough-and-tumble relationship with the President of the United States. The story he revealed was bleak and startling. According to Director Comey, President Trump was so anxious to have the FBI investigation of the president's former national security advisor, retired Lieutenant General Michael Flynn, shut down, that the president actually said in words to this effect to the former director, "I hope you can see your way to shutting down the investigation. And then, if you want to keep your job, I want you to shut down the investigation. And then, you're fired." The director interpreted those events as orders from the president and offers from the president, which, if examined under the light of the criminal law, are probably unlawful. Can the president of the United States be indicted for a crime while he is the president of the United States? The short answer is no. The constitutional remedy
for presidential criminal wrongdoing, if there is any here, would be impeachment. I hesitate to use that word. My generation lived through the almost impeachment of Bill Clinton and the actual impeachment with the almost impeachment of Richard Nixon and the actual impeachment without conviction of Bill Clinton. But in this case, even though Director Comey assured President Trump three times that he was not the subject of an FBI investigation, we know that he now is. The tables were turned by Jim Comey's testimony. Whether you like Comey or not, the testimony was believable and compelling that the president entered into an area from which presidents are excluded. That is the decision about who to prosecute and how to prosecute that person. And by entering that area, according to Comey, with an offer of a job in return for compliance with his wishes in that area, he pushed this into the realm of the special prosecutor for investigation. Nobody knows where this is going to go. Donald Trump is right. The White House is under siege. Some of this is the manner in which Donald Trump has chosen to operate his presidency. Much of it is the people surrounding the White House who still can't bear the thought that a person they really dislike and fear is the lawful president of the United States. We'll see where this goes. This is the first chapter of many in which the president's adversaries in the intelligence community, in the law enforcement community, and in the political community are waging a rather uncivilized war against him. Welcome to my channel.